So good evening, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here, and I feel really privileged to be a guest of this fantastic webinar series. Thank you, Carlos. My best congratulations for the big effort and you've done putting up this series. But I feel a bit, just a second. Yes, a bit embarrassed giving a talk after this master's that share the same topic we are going to talk tonight. So most of the most important issues around TFCC and DRUJ have already been discussed, starting from the pathomechanics to the clinical examination and so on. So tonight we are going to discuss about the classification management of the TFCC tests. So I'm going to make a quick recall about the current classification in use nowadays and to discuss the facts behind a new classification and why the arthroscopic diagnosis of the peripheral tear is so important to perform, and also how that information may lead to different treatment options. There I will discuss basically the arthroscopic possibilities. So the goals of a classification, we all agree that basically we must define the type of injury, its location, severity, prognosis, in order to have guidelines for treatment. And we also expect that a classification can facilitate the assessment of outcome and basically the comparisons between the different techniques. Palmer classification was described in the light in the 90s, and it's a very nice classification when it defines the location of the injuries in the different aspect of the TFC complex, because we have to recall that the triangular fibular cartilage is actually a complex of tissues in those small space. Probably it lacks in describing the severity and the prognosis. So we need this to provide a proper treatment, and that can be probably improved. It's very good for us to know that there are, on the radial side of the TFC, there are two different types of injuries. The 1A that involves the central disc, and the 1D, which is the radial tears of the TFC. It's very important to recognize the involvement of the 1A, the central disc, from the attachment on the of the radial ulnar ligament on the at the edges of the sigma notch, like the 1D. What is the clinical relevance? In 1A tears, you have a stable DRUJ, and the only thing you can do is to debride the cartilaginous tissue that is not going to heal if you even try to repair it. You can debride with several options. Instead, in case of 1D tears, you have the radial avulsion of the distal radial ulnar ligament, and that should be repaired. Toshi Nakamura attempted a sub-classification recognizing the pure ligamentous avulsion on the first row on the from the avulsion with fragment of the distal radius. Clinically, these are very important because they are associated to an unstable DRUJ. It should be repaired, of course, either by fixing the fragment back to the distal radius, or using these new devices that allow for all-inside repair of the ligament back to the, its anatomical insertion. That will restore the RUJ stability. Another class of another type of TFCC tear are those palmar tears involved with the ulna kappa ligament, the 1C. You see, this is the original description, a longitudinal tear just distal to the palmar distal radio-ulnar ligament that can, as you see here, it can be debrided and repaired with an all-inside arthroscopic suture, as you see in the video now. And this is the typical description. So compared to the first description of the palmar 1C, this horizontal tear, actually the most common tears are those longitudinal vertical tears, as you see here, which were lately described by Dick Berger. And these tears also benefit from arthroscopic treatment. Arthroscopy is very good in diagnosing it. And as you see here, we can also perform some repair using a percutaneous suturing and all inside repair. This condition may cause a kind of ulnar-carpal instability, which is, in my opinion, very difficult to diagnose and classify. So you see here, the repair of the ulnar-carpal ligament provides a restoration of proper trampoline effect. So, but it's very important that our classification can help us to define the type of injury, especially in the ulnar or peripheral tear, the so-called type 1D, which have the most important clinical relevance in everyday's clinical practice. And arthroscopy also improve a lot in the diagnosis of these kind of tears. First of all, describing the, that the location is not exactly on the medial aspect of the TSCC, but more on the dorsal aspect. A nice paper from the group of PCO in Hong Kong described that almost more than half of these tear in this patient series didn't fit Palmer's classification, and they found this kind of dorsal tear quite common. The other problem that came from these studies was that almost half of the patients having fair or poor results were related to DRUJ instability. The same results were reached by this series from the Mayo Clinic comparing open and arthroscopic repair of the TFCC. They showed that 70% of patients showed DRUJ instability requiring reoperation. So the conclusion were that it was very common to be underestimate DRUJ instability or to provide adequate TFCC repair. Before those paper, Tommy Lindau was the first one to describe the condition that peripheral tear were strongly associated to DRUJ instability. So in spite of this kind of tear, you see, which is along the path of the ligaments, if you see in this coronal sagittal observation, you see a coronal tear, a coronal capsular detachment. But if you consider the most proximal aspect of the tear, you might suspect that this lesion can cause the foveal avulsion leading to DRUJ instability. That confirmed the studies of Toshi Nakamura that the proximal aspect, the deep portion, so-called deep portion of the TFCC, is torn when you have DRUJ instability. We were studying the same problem on those shears, and we found that the tampoline effect may be alterated, but when you put your probe in the tear and you move your scope from radio cap 3-4 portal to a DRUJ portal in a patient with an unstable DRUJ, you can see the tip of your probe in the DRUJ with the detached ligaments. So understanding severity is very important for those there. And at the beginning of 2000, it was very important to understand that the general surgeons were, there were two groups actually of surgeons dealing with the DRUJ. The surgeons making open surgery and those making arthroscopic surgery. And there was a lot of discussion because at that time, open surgery was dealing with DRUJ instability. And it looked like arthroscopic surgery may deal only with capsular tears. There were a lot of discussion, especially in the anatomical lab, as you see here, the fantastic lab where we learn a lot in Barcelona, the lab directed by Manel Jusa, with the help of Margasi Elias, Alex Juke. We learn a lot of anatomy to better understand the pathomechanics of this tear. And also we learn how to avoid some big mistake, as you see here, a swollen wrist using arthroscopy with saline. You know very well that I am very fond of dry arthroscopy. A lot of research were going on also with the help of the EWA Society, a big group of surgeons devoted to wrist arthroscopy that helped the development of these new ideas around the TFCC. The basic thing is that the complex or the TFC is a very sophisticated area. As you see here in this slide by Makoto Tamai, we can consider this area, which is the traditional aspect that you can see when you perform a radiocarpal arthroscopy, that can resemble the hammock structure, which is the shock absorbing part of the TFCC. But this is only the distal component of the TFCC. In fact, it also has a proximal component, which is a very sophisticated structure that is made up by the distal radio-ulnar ligament that inserts into the foveal area. And in fact, these are the biomechanically stabilizer, the most important stabilizer of the DRUJ. The foveal area also gives insertion to the palmar uno carpal ligament, which are very important for the stability of the ulna carpal joint. So from the hammock concept, we have to move towards what I call the iceberg concept. This concept consider the TFCC like an iceberg. When you are scoping the radiocarpal joint, you are looking at the tip of the iceberg that comes out of the water, but you know very well that the most important part are submerged and below the level of the water. So the most important part of the TFCC are the DRUJ stabilizer, the carpal stabilizer, that can be seen only when you perform a radiocarpal, a DRUJ arthroscopy. So understanding this concept is very important to underline the role of arthroscopy and the importance of performing DRUJ arthroscopy if you want to assess the quality of the foveal insertions of the TFCC. It would the trampoline test is very good to assess the distal part of the TSCC. This is a typical trampoline effect. But if you want to check the rupture or the foveal insertion, you have to scope the DRUJ. So to make arthroscopic assessment more easy, it would be good to perform radiocarpal arthroscopy and also provide information about the foveal insertion. And we found that that could be done using the Hook test. The Hook test tried to elevate the distal insertion of the TSCC. As you see here, you introduce in, your probe into the rosaceous, and you lift the peripheral TFCC toward the middle of the joint. That would provide information about the competence of the foveal ligaments.
The trampoline and hook tests are performed using a probe which is introduced into the zigzag portal, where the scope is viewing from 3-4 portal. In the negative trampoline test, compressive loading on the central disc causes sperm bouncing. When the probe cannot elicit TFCC rebound, the test is considered positive, indicating peripheral TFCC tear. The Hook test is performed by introducing a probe as deep as possible into the pre-styloid recess and then applying traction to the ulnar border of the TFCC. The test is considered positive when the TFCC is pulled up towards the middle radiocarpal joint, indicating incompetence of the foveal insertion of the TFCC.
Okay, so I hope you you could hear this the video. Could you?
Yes, that was fine.
Yeah. Okay. So it was very important to watch the way the probe was introduced in into the recessus and the way the hand of the surgeon try to elevate the peripheral part of the TCC from the ulna. That's very important. So starting from that, it's very easy to understand that type 1D definition is actually a defective definition, because we can actually have some different types of tear. The isolated involvement of the distal part of the TSCC, so-called the class 1, or a complete tear involving both the distal part and also the foveal insertion, or an isolated proximal tear, which is a quite tricky condition in which the radiocarpal exploration shows no damage on the evaluation, which is the clinical relevance of these two, three classes. That class one is very different from the remaining two and three, because the latter are associated with unstable DRUJ, which is a quite difficult condition to treat. So it's very important to recognize the different anatomical level of injury. They have different findings on the side of the clinical DRUJ instability, and also different arthroscopic signs, both on, in the radiocarpal joint and distal radio ulna joint. The class one distal tear is a typical tear, which is associated with a positive Hook test. So the Hook test doesn't show any the DRUJ problem. The problem with a class two is that you have a complete tear that can be seen on the radiocarpal arthroscopy, but also you have a positive Hook test with the torn DRUJ ligament. Clinically, the patient showed DRUJ instability. And also, if you perform a DRUJ arthroscopy, you can see a massive tear of the foveal insertion of the ligament. A different condition is very peculiar. This is the proximal tear. They show no visible tear and at radiocarpal exploration, but when you perform the Hook test or the ROJ arthroscopy, you see the avulsion of the ligament, as you see here in this distal radial ulnar joint arthroscopy. So in my experience, the amount of proximal tear is not so little, up to 15%. I found in this patient with the positive fovea sign. Just to recall you that when you perform a radiocarpal arthroscopy with a suspect of the DRUJ instability, you should always perform a DRUJ arthroscopy or use the hook test to rule out any damage inside the DRUJ. Another issue is related to the chronicity of these injuries. Usually, we're used to define acute or chronic injury according to the duration of symptoms, if they are less or more than 6 months. The imaging actually is of limited value because it cannot show the tissue quality or the healing potential, which is the truly important matter when we have to define this condition. In fact, we have to recognize if this green area is still working with good vascularity, good blood supply to the tear edges that otherwise cannot repair. So we can have a green light for this repairable tear, but instead we cannot hope to repair this large tear with degenerated edges that or this kind of other tear may raise some doubt. But if you have a tunic, if you remove the tunicate release, you can see how quick is the blood in this area. I want to show you again the difference between this condition and also this one. You see how the edges are soft and they are very supple and they're totally different. You can understand this only if you use the probe making the arthroscopy. This is different from this tear here, in which you see it's very difficult to debride with a shaver, and the shaver cannot remove this sclerotic tissue. And if you remove the tunicate, as I'm doing here, you can wait for long and see no bleeding inside the joint. At the level of the tear, well, instead you can see some bleeding up here. So that means that the tear edges are not vascularized, they are not going to heal if tried to repair. You can also have different condition like this frayed ligament that cannot hold any suture, so it's not suitable to repair in this condition. So in my idea is to change the definition between acute and chronic tears and better talk about repairable or irreparable tears. And this definition can be provided only using arthroscopy, and that can give us the best hint to choose an appropriate treatment. A suture can be performed for repairable tear, and reconstruction is the treatment of choice for irreparable tears. The other condition to assess is the status of the cartilage of the DRUJ, either the ulnar head or the sigmoid notch. As in cases with an arthritic joint, there is no indication for reconstruction. So according to this concept, we are going to define five different classes in which we can divide the so-called Palmer 1B type of peripheral tears. Class one, that represent the repairable distal tear, which are associated to none or minor DRUJ, instability, I should be treated absolutely with arthroscopic suture. We all understand that making an open approach to repair this tear at the very dorsal edge of the tear may cause more damage than benefit, and arthroscopic suture is the absolutely is absolutely indicated. I like very much the outside-in technique proposed by Jan Osved, but recently Paco del Pignal proposed this technique of an all-inside repair, as you see here, in that requires some skills, especially in feeling the needle when it's retrieved back the joint. You see the first needle is in the firstly the needle is introduced within the joint, and then the extremity or the suture is repaired, then it withdrawn a little bit just to exit the capsule, and then it comes back again inside the joint. And the suture is looping here, so it can be grasped with a mosquito from the 6R portal here. It's a very quick technique. It requires a bit of feeling on the tip of your fingers to understand when the tip of the needle exit the joint, but it is very fast. It provides a very fast and good repair for these class one tears. So the repair of the distal tear, so this ligament to capsule suture provide very good or excellent result, as this study shows. Class two and three are those type of tears that are associated to a proximal rupture, foveal rupture, or the insertion. So they are associated to major DRUJ instability and require a foveal refixation as an optimal treatment. The refixation can be performed by different means, like using a suture anchor or a knotless suture repair or transosseous repair, or there are many kinds of repair. I would like to share with you the key points for the foveal reinsertion. First of all, we have to understand that providing repair at the foveal area is the basic step of your repair. No associated procedure are required, such as reefing or the extensor retinaculum or the ECU tendon sheath or a capsular reefing. They are not required because the anatomical area of isometric area of repair is the foveal area, and that should be the aim of our repair. Another key point is that we need to prepare for best healing, especially when you're not dealing with acute tear. You need to remove scar tissue from the TFCC, from the foveal area, to create fresh bleeding area of the opposing surfaces and provide the best quality of tissue when you're dealing with the repair. Hopefully, you must create a good footprint, a large contact area between the TFCC tissues and the fovea. If you use a bone anchor and also a sliding knot, you also provide a forceful compression of your knot and the tissue. You're pushing the tissue against the bone in order to increase the contact between the two healing tissues. In my opinion, in order to restore the best anatomy, a suture should be addressed to anyone and each of the dorsal and palmar radio-ulnar ligament. So I consider the best repair when you provide a ligament-specific suture, one going to the dorsal DRUJ ligament and the other one going to the palmar DRUJ ligament. Especially the palmar suture is very important because tightening the palmar radio-ulnar ligament, you're also restoring proper tension of the ulnar kappa ligament, which are a key constituent of the TFCC. So the requisite for the ideal foveal repair is that we don't have any associated extra-articular disorder. So we must be very careful in the preoperative clinical diagnosis to exclude ECU tendon problem or rupture of the ECU tendon sheet that it should be addressed very accurately. The important advancement, in my opinion, to perform this repair by arthroscopy is the introduction of the DF portal, which is actually palmar DRUJ portal located about 1 centimeter proximal to the 6U portal. And another very important concept is that when you are making arthroscopy in the standard arthroscopic setup, you have the foramen in neutral pronos supination. And in this condition, the foveal area may be difficult to reach. Instead, if you put the foramen in full supination, you are displacing dorsal walls, the ECU tendon, the extensor, ulnar styloid, so you can get an easy way to the fovea, which is just underneath the skin of your when you rest in full supination, just palmar to the ulnar styloid. So this is the anatomical and the sketching of it's easy to reach this area. The DF portal can be used to shave, refresh the foveal area, and also to introduce the anchor. You can have this portal or with the suture coming out that can be introduced inside the joint again to perform the repair. I just want to remember you that there are some nerve structure, very important, very close to this portal. So a small opening may be indicating in the general surgeon. I believe that expert surgeon can simply have a good management of the soft tissue, especially using a very careful spreading of the soft tissues around the portal, and especially using dry arthroscopy may prevent any damage on the dorsal branch of the ulnar nerve that runs very close to the DF and 6U portal. This is a video how this technique can be performed using a small opening to evaluate and protect the dorsal branch of the ulnar nerve. You see again how it works, that you get the foveal area very easily when you supinate the wrist. So with this small opening, a curette can be used to debride the foveal area and prepare for anchor introduction. As you see here, it's a screw that provides two strong pair of sutures into the foveal area that can be performed with this small opening. You see here the sutures that are coming from the foveal area, and then they are introduced into the DRUJ. You see with this this needle, they go flush to the foveal area, and then you can check using arthroscopy into the radiocarpal joint. Using the mosquito, you can retrieve the suture from the 6U portal, and then you can do the same from both the palmar and the dorsal radio-ulnar ligament using the arthroscope to retrieve the suture. Here you can make a sliding knot and provide a strong fixation. Here is made using a mosquito, but you can also use a nut pusher. It's very good to learn how to make a sliding knot. These are some kind of locking knots that can provide good stability on the first throw you perform, and they lock when they are introduced inside the joint. They are very useful to learn how to perform this knot, which is not common for a standard hand surgeon. It's more common for shoulder surgeons. But it's very easy to learn. You see, locking knot is very, very fast to perform. So if you look at the literature about the class 2 and 3 peripheral tears, we see that we have very good results from different kind of arthroscopic repair. Among these kind of repair, we can recognize those that require include a foveal debridement. They are different from those that do not require foveal debridement. And you see the difference in some kind of persistence of pain and DRUJ instability in those in which the foveal debridement was not performed. That underlines the importance to make accurate debridement of the foveal area before making the actual repair technique. So the class 4 is a class in which the tear is not repairable, and so a tendon graft is reconstruction is recommended. We along with PCO, we work in arthroscopic modification of the ADANS technique, which is currently the gold standard in this technique. And we make the arthroscopic procedure that aiming to get a minimal invasive procedure in order to help and reduce the difficulties of rehabilitation. And we saw it is technically feasible. The best advantage is in the early postoperative pain, which is reduced compared to the open technique, as I saw in my early cases years ago. And also the rehabilitation is easier, especially in the early phases when we have a reduced stiffness of the joint. Actually, the technique involves a small opening on the dorsal and palmar aspect, along with another small opening on the ulnar side of the wrist, in order to perform a tunnel across the distal radius and across the distal ulna. Then some portals are also performed to check the joint inside and see and check for a good, a proper passage of the tendon. From these early experiences, we found the best advantage of this technique is that compared to the standard ADAPT procedure that deploys the tendon underneath the TFCC remnant, using this technique, we can introduce the tendon between the ulnolunate and ulnotriquetal ligament. In this case, we are going to provide stability also to the ulnocarpal ligament. And that makes a true, a complete reconstruction of the TFC complex, not only the DRUJ ligament. You see the grasper that passes through the ulnocarpal ligament from the dorsal to palmar to the dorsal 4-5 portal to the palmar opening in order to deliver the palmar extremity of the tendon graft. So the this extremity of the of the tendon is passed between the ulna lunate and ulna triquet and some ligament, just distal to the palmar the ulna ligament, in order to restore proper tension of the TFCC. Another big advantage of arthroscopy is using the arthroscopic devices such as these interference screws that can speed up the fixation and improve the fixation of the tendon graft in the ulnar tunnel. So we also have very small interference screws that may fit even the smaller ulna. This is the intraoperative aspect after you restore the, you fix the graft, you see this palmar aspect coming from the ulna kappa ligament up here. Good stability. Reviewing the cases, we saw that the in the long term, we have some recurrence of the laxity of the and also of the instability, and the limitation of this arthroscopic Adams procedure is that we still continue to struggle with the important structure that are very close to the palmar approach. This is the palmar approach, which is very close to the ulna neurovascular bundle, and also the dorsal approach, this is one, is very close to the extendo tendon, as well as the medial approach is very close to the dorsal branch of the ulna nerve. Another limitation, this technique, is related to the location of the radial tunnel, which is not anatomical at all. The anatomical site of the insertion was discussed by Luis Schreker as well in this lecture, is located at the edges of the sigmoid notch. And instead, the tunnel is far proximal to the anatomical insertion that may cause a conflict between the tendon and the ulna head, especially in pronation. You see here that may cause a progressive elongation of the tendon graft or even a rupture, as happened in different cases. That's why many surgeons try to develop the alternative technique. I like very much this technique proposed by Louis Schecker, which is very clever technique, or this technique proposed also recently by Vicente Caratalà, that included some half tunnels at the distal radius in which a interference screws can be introduced in order to block the tendon graft on the radius, and that fix the loop that comes out the ulna tunnel with an interference screw, as you see here. We try to develop an arthroscopic anatomic all inside technique. We work with many different techniques aiming to reach a accurate anatomical location of the radial origins with limited invasivity, no fluoroscopy, no open approach that may cause problem with the soft tissues around the joint. And we created a converging tunnel and arthroscopic guidance to permit a tendon gliding into the radius. This is performed using a drill guide, which is introduced under arthroscopic control. As you see here, the first tunnel is driven from the radial metaphysis into the joint, as you see here, and then we move the guide inside the tunnel in order to perform to reach with the second tunnel the tip of the guide, which is within the within the first tunnel. You see here, so the guide is rotated, is aimed against the dorsal corner or the distal radius in order to perform the second half of the tunnel. Then a loop is used to deploy the tendon graft inside the joint, as you see here, coming out from the palmar aspect and then introduced between the palmar ulna carpal ligament, just distal to the remnants of the palmar distal radio ulna ligament. You see here. Then a sutural lasso and is introduced into the ulna tunnel in order to pull the extremities of the tendon inside the ulna head. This is what when the tendons come into the ulna tunnel, and the interference screws is used to secure the tendon inside the ulna head. You see. This peculiar way of introduction also increases the tension of the tendon. As you see here at the end of the repair, the tendon exiting from the palmar border of the sigmoid notch that going to the ulna carpal ligament and then into the foveal area. And then, and also you see on the right hand of the screen, the dorsal part of the ligament. So they showed quite good results. We also, obviously, we have a limited follow-up and we are looking for longer follow-up. Obviously, arthritic DRUJ class 5 is not treated by ligament reconstruction or repair, but should be treated by arthroplasty. Usually this technique is performed by open procedure, but the arthroscopy can also allow for a treatment of this arthritic joint. Ricardo Lucchetti described a technique in which a Sauvé Capenge can be performed using the arthroscopic equipment, and the arthroscopy is performed through the central disc area of the TFCC, which is debrided, and so the burr are introduced into the sigma into the DRUJ to reject the subchondral bone, the cartilage remnant, and expose the subchondral bone in order to prepare for the DRUJ fusion. You see here some quick steps, and when the joint ends are debrided, the new disc from the cartilage, the pinning is performed, and also an anchor in a screw is introduced to fuse the joint, and then percutaneous resection of the ulna neck is performed, and then eventually an additional KY can be used to increase stability of the ulna head fusion. This minimally invasive approach helps to respect the soft tissue sleeve around the distal ulna and prevent gross instability of the ulna stump, which is a major issue in this kind of procedure. So in order to conclude, the question still remains, which is the key for a successful repair of peripheral TFCC tear. In my opinion, and according to the step we recommend to develop this classification and treatment algorithm, the diagnosis should be the first and most important step of your approach to these kind of tears. Perspective are changing. You should move from the traditional, quite limited concept of the hammock towards a more complex concept of the iceberg. that respect the complexity of the anatomy, which is peculiar of the, especially of the ulnar side of the TFCC. Don't forget to remember that when you are assessing the TFCC from the radial kappa joint, you are looking at only the tip of the iceberg, and the bulky part resides below the sea level, below the water. That means you don't forget the foveal attachment and the information provided by DLUJ arthroscopy and the use of the hook test. So only in this case you can perform an appropriate repair. And I believe it's very important not to forget that your diagnostic approach should be truly comprehensive. And according to the four-leaf clover approach proposed by Margaret C. Elias, you should assess all the structures that constitute the distal radio-ulnar joint area. So don't forget about muscle and tendons. Don't forget about bone morphology and quality, which means be careful about CRPS or bone stock in the osteopenic patient or ulnar plus variant patient. And don't forget about the chondral effect. Once you've ruled out everything and you must deal with your arthroscopy. So as Mark stated about the long winding road, this is the same journey also for the DRUJ. And we start driving many years ago. As you see from the rear mirror, we left a very bad road behind our shoulders. And now we can drive quite safely going ahead and hopefully taking with us the junior, the younger colleagues that want to follow this road. But the journey is still very long. In fact, we still have a lot of different tests like this. One recently described by Paco del Pignal, Toshi Nakamura, the so-called coronal tears that are more common than usually thought. These are located in the in a coronal plane between the two insertion of the uno, radio, distal radio ulna ligament that may be created with a buttonholing mechanism of the ulnar head that opens the connecting tissues between the two insertion of the ligament. This intersection of the ligament is ruptured, but this there, so you can have an unstable DRUJ, but the ligament are still attached to the fovea. In this case, only arthroscopy can provide a good repair, performing a side-to-side suture that restore proper tensioning quite often along with a wafer procedure. And you can imagine that if you perform this repair by an open procedure, you're going to destroy the remnants of these ligaments. So this is a new horizon that arthroscopy can show, and this is only one part. I think there are many, many others still to come. Thank you for your attention. I hope we can have a lot of questions ahead. Thank you very much.